This is like pure happiness. Okay, we have this pure happiness here. And we're afraid of it. We say, wow, look at this pure happiness. I'm not used to that. We've been trying to avoid pure happiness, right? Trying to avoid it. And we realize it's still here. It's still here. So within us, we realize that the pure happiness is still with us. And we say, gosh, what do we do? What do we do? Now, there's two different ways to deal with this. One of them is to double down on failure. Double down on failure. And the other is to realize you have a continuity problem. And those are two different directions entirely. Those who are doubling down on failure are going, will insist that, well, they may say, I have a continuity problem, but doubling down on failure is the way to resolve it. Because they say we have to change reality so that the continuity problem will disappear, because we're just going to stick with what we got. Well, that's not really a continuity problem, is it? If you just say, I'm going to stick with what I got, as far as this scenario of failure of existence, that's not really a continuity problem. A continuity problem means you're going from one situation to another. That's what it really means. So it is a denial. It is a denial of the continuity problem. So either deny you have a continuity problem or you accept it. Two different directions entirely. And again, what is the continuity problem? We have this plate, the list of utmost happiness here. Plate of utmost happiness that never diminishes, never goes away. Just this plate of gold. You know, it's just this feast of golden happiness, actually. It just is vast and endless and pure and smooth and untroubled, process-free, no strategy, measureless, concept-free happiness, causation-free, it's intrinsic. And it says, this is so nice, this plate of happiness. So we have to eat this plate of happiness. We have to see the plate of happiness. Say, behold the plate of happiness. And so we rehearse that. This is the wise way. We can't spend all our time bemoaning the shenanigans of those who decide to double down on failure, decide to double down on failure, on unhappiness, saying that they'll be happy once they succeed at destroying happiness. Okay? The way of destructivity says that no problem. It said we're going to be very happy once we are able to destroy reality. That's where our happiness will come from. And that's just a wishful thinking. It's a whim. So we know that we cannot destroy happiness. This is what the great sages have told us. We cannot destroy happiness. It's impossible. We cannot destroy reality. It's impossible. So all of the beauty and glory and pure happiness of reality is still within us. So we really have no choice but to begin to reorient to that. Now, how we reorient to that is something that there are various ways can occur to us, can be suggested to us. But we certainly have to understand the principle of this, that we have this continuity problem. We're used to extreme ugliness, actually. Everything in this world is basically extremely ugly. Everything is basically extremely ugly because nothing is permanent. Right? And that's not what we like. We don't like that. We just enjoy the beauty here. Just letting the neighbors do their thing. Give us the time to enjoy the beauty, right? Yes. This is what we need to do. Now, form may seem to have some beauty. We look at it and say, oh, it's beautiful. But I have found that actually using words can be even more powerful, because we tend to get an attachment to the form, and when it's gone, we say, oh, you know, that these are all going to dry up and eventually be gone. And it's, whereas the words, abstract words, I see the absolutely sparkling, scintillating, never-ending, gorgeous, rarely, you know, just as intrinsic, rare, striated with the most incredible filigree, golden beauty and well, there's a plane. So, some more here. Some more. Laced, saturated, filigree, gilded, with the most scintillating, shimmering, gorgeous, endlessly expansive, golden light. And you see, we don't have to plant all the flowers and tend to them and weed them and garden them and prune them and wait for the seasons to come. We can use the words right every moment. And this helps us with the continuity problem. The Arati ceremonies that the Hindus use is, I believe, somewhat along the lines of that, the showing us the beauty of light in the darkness, right? How beautiful, when we're stumbling around in the dark, how beautiful does light appear to us? Is it not? Just think about that. When you're on a dark, dark trail with snakes and wild animals going through the jungle, and it's so scary, so rough, so stressful. And you have a lantern, you know, burning this oil, and you can see, and how grateful you are for that light, to be able to see in the darkness. And also the formlessness of the flame, beautiful formlessness of it, as it dances formlessly, and you say, that reminds me of spirit, does it not? Not trapped here. not trapped in form, not trapped in definition, not depending on not valuing definition of what it is. So there is that quality of the fire ceremonies, and this is, you know, this is just something similar to that. It's showing something very beautiful to remind us of the beauty that is actually within us. The beauty of that is within us is like a mountain. Imagine a massive mountain of this. Imagine you're looking out and there's this, wherever you are, out your front door, a mountain arises, and it arises up into the sky, like Mount Everest, and it's huge, it's an incredible massive mountain. It's all made of this, like this, all like this, shimmering and glowing with purity and great fragrance. And you hear a humming sound, a beautiful humming sound from it. Another interlude here. Imagine a mountain of this. And so we're just looking at this bright, clean, massive mountain. It's bright and clean. This whole mountain of these, this gorgeousness is just bright and clean and fresh. Bright and clean and fresh. It is divine. It is transcendently fresh. It is unlimitedly fresh and clean. Divinely fresh and clean. It is this exquisite holy mountain that is just lofty, so lofty, this incredibly lofty mountain with beautiful tone. The whole mountain has this beautiful tone, just this tinkling, beautiful tinkling tone coming from the entire mountain of this gorgeousness like this. 1 minute. So we're just imagining this beauty. It's colossal, colossal mountain. Massive, stupendous, impressive. And it's flawless in its beauty. It has this flawless beauty, entirely flawless beauty here. Entirely flawless beauty. And it's completely unclouded. It's all revealed. There's no clouds, there's no fog obscuring it whatsoever. It all stands totally revealed to us. And it's splendid. It is pure. It is so pure and natural and splendid. And sublime. Totally freshly sublime. Just the freshness is sublime. And off of this freshness just cascades just this a fullness of tone. It's not really a song or a hymn. It's just everything is emitting this tone. And all the tones are so pure and fresh and beautiful. They don't conflict with one another. You don't have to arrange the tones. You don't have to harmonize the tones. And you say, oh, this is so immaculate. It's all immaculate. It's all faultless. It's all blameless. It's all spotless. There's no blemishes to it. I don't need to think about it. I don't need to do anything about it. I don't need to go anywhere. I don't need to try. I don't need to know anything about it. I don't need to be anything. It's just there. Don't need to arrange or harmonize any of the notes. Just, you're just listening to the overall vibe and hum and beautiful of all these pure tones. And all the light, all the tones of light of all of this is so harmonious. You see, do we have to rearrange anything in here? Think about that. Do I need to go in and say, wait a minute, you know, let me put this one here and this one there? Or is it just okay to just let it be just like that? Just let it be just like that. Just let it be just like that. Is that okay? So the great mighty mountain, the great mighty mountain that extends this way and it extends this way. As far as the eye can see, there's this great mighty mountain. Or you may want to have it like a pyramid, a great mighty pyramid like in front of you. And the whole thing is just this incredibly precious, matchless, delicate, mystical, sacred, sheer beauty, cascading, light cascading, tone cascading, fragrance cascading. Nothing you need to do or arrange or harmonize. Very important. So we say, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to think anything. I don't need to ask anything. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to go anywhere. I don't have to seek anything. I don't have to find anything. I don't have to fix anything. I don't have to heal anything. I don't have to arrange anything. I do not have to heal anything. I do not have to harmonize anything. Just let it be. Just let it be. Just enjoy it. Now, the great challenge for a musician is to just let it be. I can tell you from the standpoint of being a longtime musician. There was one time back in maybe the late 1970s, 1978, where I had a dream and I heard the music of the spheres. What I heard was every last thing, everything, everything. The mountain, as a matter of fact. And everything on the mountain, the whole mountain was singing, was emitting these tones, these beautiful tones. The whole universe, everything was emitting these pure tones, beautiful tones, each one different. And yet they all seemed to be in harmony with one another, intrinsically. And I awoke from that dream just shaking and just saying, it was too much for me. I said, wow, this is like infinitely better than any song I could ever compose. Infinitely, there's no comparison. And I said, what in the world is this? What in the world is this? But I heard it. I absolutely was aware of it. And I say, I want to hear that again. But the key is, don't try and say, wait a minute, okay. Don't try to make a song out of it. Don't try to grasp and say, wait, okay, there's an idea. I'm going to make a song now. Okay, let me just take a little snapshot of it. And I can compose a song out of it. Because you could compose an infinite number of songs, but none of them would be what this is. None of them. Because this is effortless. It's supremely lovely and beautiful and godly and matchless and sacred and lofty and blameless and unitary, unreduced, unfragmented, unsegmented. There is no song there. It's an endless song. And it's the endlessness to the song and the all-embracing oneness of the song. That's the whole point of it. So when you try to turn it into a concrete entity thing, here's a 3-minute song or an hour symphony or something, that's not it at all. That is not it at all. That just feeds the notion that we don't need that. We got this. Feeds the notion of finiteness. See, the thing is, these tones don't stop. They're inherently, everything has a tone. A tone essence, actually. There's a tone essence being emitted. There's also a light essence from the various relative pressures of everything. Some kind of light essence also, I've seen that too. Everything is emitting this subtle, beautiful, incredibly beautiful. You know, like this, but just to the ultimate extent. So that the key is just allow yourself to hear this and just listen, just experience it. Just experience it. Like you're going to a symphony as an audience member. You're not going there to play the symphony. You're going there to listen to the symphony. So what we do is we simply will listen, just listen and enjoy. Nothing I need to do, go, rearrange, fix, heal, change, critique, reproduce, reverse engineer, symbolize, market, package, sell. Nothing, just the universal song. This is what we hear when we set failure down. When we're trying to do all other music, we're trying to fail to hear this. Now, so when we look at all our so-called creativity in this world, we need to realize these are all defense mechanisms to fail. Because if we weren't doing that, we would be so attracted back to it. We would throw down, set down this idea of causing reality to fail, to be what it is. But instead, when we start to say, wait a minute, I want to set this down, I want to get back to what I love, truly love, the ego says, whoa, wait a minute. We got all these wonderful songs here. This is what you really want, right? you say, I don't think so. And he goes, listen. You're going to like this, you know. And then the ego starts pushing the full agenda of the sensory senses of limitedness, you know, on you. And so the ego tells us, please, I need you to compose a whole bunch of really great music because people are wanting to hear the true music and you know, we're going to fail at failure here. We don't want that, right? Continuity issue, oh, I'm afraid. And so I said, whoa, wait a minute. No. Let's work on the continuity issue here instead of composing a whole bunch of songs. Because if we work on the continuity issue properly, we'll be able to listen to the cosmic song, the true cosmic song, because it's a song of freedom, that's endless, spotless, complete, supreme, superb, splendid, exquisite, transcendent, unitary, all one, august, glorious, regal, and unreduced splendor, regal, unreduced splendor of this, and it's free, and it doesn't stop, and it's everywhere. So when the ego says, well, make a song out of it, it's saying, whoa, you got a severe, there's a severe continuity problem here. But don't let the ego be in charge of your continuity problem. Because what it'll do is it will turn you away from it and says, look, the solution is don't go back. That's what the ego will tell you. Don't go back. It says, we got good musicians here. They'll be able to compose some really cool music and that'll you'll be happy. The ego says, oh, I see you like music. Okay, here's some great music for you. See, that's what the ego will do. The ego is our fear of going back. It's our desire to be separate. So that the voice of the ego will always speak for separation and fear and say, don't go back. It's an abyss. What the ego will say, it's an abyss. Don't go back. It's going to destroy you. That's what the ego will say. It's a projection. The ego wants to destroy reality. So it's just projecting, it's denying that and projecting it on reality and saying the reality is going to destroy us somehow. Some kind of, you know, just total abyss will be destroyed. It's not true. The ego says, you gotta put that in a form. You gotta put it in a form. Wow, this is formless. It seems so formless. No, we need form. That's continuity fear. Continuity fear. So as we work at this continuity problem, it will happen at some point. There will be breakthroughs, and we will be able to experience this incredible, exquisite, lovely, sacred, transcendently divine, you know, matchless experience. And just don't put it into form. Form is an expression of our desire to be separate and ultimately continuity fear. So as our continuity fear evaporates, we're more and more open to the truly sublime. Of course, the ego will say we're stupid for not putting it into form. What's the matter? Can't you put it into form? No. We want to avoid putting it into form. Because we don't have to go at the continuity fear strictly through symbolizing what we're afraid of. For instance, like music. Say, okay, we need some really good songs to help us out. That's not necessarily the way at all. That might even make things more difficult, actually, because we say, well, wait a minute, I've got a beautiful song in a form, why should I give up form, let me keep it, that kind of thing. So we can say no need to limit this, no need to see this in a failure from the perspective of failure. No need to see this from the perspective of failure. So when our fear arises over any this formless beauty, as it were, this everything emitting these tones, and you can't say it's a song, or you could say it's an endless song, but it seems formless. You haven't been able to put it into a package. You say this concern, this irritation, just reflects my faint desire for this to fail, for this to fail to be what it is, and say, no, I'm no longer interested in this, in failure. I just have a continuity fear. This just reflects my continuity fear, where I wanted failure. Now I don't want it anymore. And you just push it aside. Say, I love this. This is wonderful. This is what I want. This is incomparably, flawlessly wonderful. It's exactly what I want. It's exactly what I want. And then recognize your resistance is simply continuity issue, and don't try to rationalize it at all. Just say, oh, okay, that's my continuity fear based on long attempt to try and limit this, to cause it to fail, what I'm experiencing now. So it's just keep owning it, the continuity fear, keep owning it. And just say, oh, I like this experience, it's wonderful. It's absolutely, it's natural, it's totally natural, it's totally lucid, it's totally immaculate, totally pure, fresh and clean. It's the full dress, unbroken, you know, faultless, spotless, blameless, blemish-free, holy, sacred experience, which is exactly what I want. And it's the formless, it's the location, location-free, form-free, word-free, effort-free. Don't let yourself get into your head or into a struggle. I call it a struggle. The struggle can be, you know, we don't need to say it's a head struggle or, you know, intellect struggle or, you know, emotional struggle. It's, the struggle can express itself in many ways. Let's just say, don't get into the struggle, a sense of struggling with it in any way, because we all have different ways of struggling. Just don't struggle with it. It's the fresh and clean, unalloyed happiness, beauty and happiness and tone. The problem is, like, if you try to help people by just saying, let me give you this great tone. I've done this, I know what I'm talking about. I was chasing tone and just did unbelievable amount of effort in that direction, trying to show people, look, what you need is this great tone. But the tone, any tone that we can produce in this world is nothing like it. It gives a false sense of security, very much a false sense of security, thinking that you can get it just by listening to music. Oh yeah, this is nice. I like the tone of this song, or I like the tone of this guitar or piano or voice or whatever. No, it gives you a false sense of progress and security. False sense. It's way better to go at it in a spiritual way. The way that we're doing is owning the continuity problem, practicing evaporating the continuity problem, understanding the theory, the context of it all. That's what I found out. I had to give up chasing the tone. I had so many guitars and amplifiers and tubes and, you know, trying to match up the exact, and trying to find the greatest tone in the world. This guitar and these strings and this chord and this amplifier and these effects boxes and this acoustics and all of this and this player and this song, and try to just the tone of it, just hear it, and you're supposed to go, ah, that's it. No, it's not it. That's not it at all. It's a false picture, an image of it, so to speak, an image of it. And then you end up worshiping the image. That's our weakness. It's our weakness. So we have to be very careful about that. Now, we can't do away with all symbols because we live in a world full of symbols. We have flowers here, of course. So, you know, you can't just, you know, encase yourself in a tomb because even that, there may be some symbol there. So, it's a matter of making sure that the horse is in front of the cart and we're spending our time in the sober quietness, absorbing the breakthroughs. Can we be in a situation where we're able to absorb hearing the tone of everything? Can we do that, you see? Remaining motionless. You don't grab a pen and paper and say, wow, let me write these notes down. Let me sequence and arrange and harmonize these notes. No, you stay within yourself, within your poise, your repentance. And say, let me just get used to this. I need to get used to this. The freedom of it, the formlessness of it. 1 minute here. So let us say that we see the beautiful light from everything, and we think, oh my gosh, I need to paint this. Let us say we see something, you know, emitting this beautiful light, and we say, oh my gosh, I need to go paint this. I want to do a painting. I'm inspired. No. That's a reflection of your continuity fear. Now, our continuity fear is so severe that we have invented this idea that there's a God that desires us to, whatever glimpse of beauty we get, desires us to express it in form, and that's supposedly what we're supposed to be doing. That's God's, we're God's creation, that we're supposed to be expressing everything in form. This is just an expression of the continuity fear. It's not true. God impresses us to experience, but not in form. In content only. So know that when we feel like, oh, I'm supposed to put this into form, that's an expression of your continuity fear. And if you understand that it is the continuity fear, then you're in control. You say, okay. My fear is this beauty is going to overwhelm me. That's our real fear. Is that this glory is going to overwhelm me. And to some extent, you know, our continuity fear, that's how it's feeling it. Like, wow, this is like endless. This is formless. This is just immeasurable. And we think we need to be able to measure it. We can't measure it. So we get like, wow, it's overwhelming, too much. Or it's overflowing. This is merely expression of our continuity fear. So we can intelligently work with it, deal with it, work with it. Say, okay, don't struggle. I'm not going to struggle with this. I'm not going to put into any form. I'm going to refuse to do that, or at least minimize it to a large extent. We're not trying to attack beauty or anything like that. We recognize, sure, there's some, you know, beautiful flowers, relatively so. We realize it's just a faint echo reminder, maybe a little nudge or something like that. But we're not iconoclastic towards the world. But we're smart, and we realize we have a severe continuity problem, and that's what's preventing us from truly experiencing what we really want to experience. We don't really want to experience these flowers. No, that's like, you know, the stale crumbs. We want to go beyond the form. We want to go to the indescribable in terms of form, in terms of measurement, in terms of data. It's indescribable in those terms. In terms of words. To going to be able to just abide in this, just abide in it without trying to package it. Don't package it. Don't package it. We're not just some country bumpkins that stumbled across something and says, oh my gosh, I could make a fortune packaging this. We're very intelligent, focused beings who understand we have this huge, severe continuity problem which is keeping us from experiencing what we truly want to experience. And therefore, we are engaged in consciously and intelligently managing our expectations in the right direction. So we see something truly beautiful, say, okay, I expected this. And then we manage our fear, we manage our, let's not pull back from it too much, let's not struggle here, let's just see if we can abide in this. Because we're going back permanently. We're going back to glory on a permanent basis here. This is just not a glimpse we're after. So when it shows up, just say, okay, well, that's fine, but I'm not after just a glimpse of it. And so I'm not after just a day of it. Not after a 5-minute high, you know, that's not what I'm after. You know, the thing with drugs is, you know, the quick high, boom, it peaks, boom, off, okay, gone, oh, wow. You know, no, we're not after that. Nothing like that. We're after permanence here. We're after abiding in it permanently. So we're not going to get overreact to anything. Not going to struggle with it. If it doesn't stay, okay. Doesn't stay, continuity fear. Let me keep working on the continuity fear. So a real problem is abidance. So when let's say something would happen to show up, like, look at these beautiful flowers. Oh my gosh, you know, so wonderful. Say, well, okay, yes, but will they stay? I'm interested in staying with this experience more than just how wonderful it is. Because otherwise, the option is to try and grasp it, to contain it, to package it, to imprison it. Put it into form that you can some story, you know. You just say, okay, let it stay, let it stay, let it stay. Let me work on just allowing it to stay, knowing that it only goes away because of our fear. Just let it stay. So we have this in the background here. We're just letting it stay there. I'm not focusing on, like, oh my God, you know, just let it stay there. Just let it be there. Is it possible to see the so-called astral beauty even when we're here in this world? Absolutely it is. Absolutely it is. Now, the big mistake in when this body is set down, if we choose to do so, then we will certainly see there will be greater, you know, see greater beauty in the astral plane, the astral level. And the thing is, don't come back to this level of trying to package it and put it into form, like denser form. No, there's, that's not God telling us to do that. That's our own idea of wanting to cause reality to fail that has us doing this. By fail, I mean to fail to be what it is. which is timeless, which is time-space free, which is pure freedom, pure happiness, timeless, formless. That's what reality is, actually. And so this is all an expression of our desire to change reality, to cause reality to fail to be what it is. This is an expression of that. So we're not certainly not going to go into a denser expression of it. And it does happen that we may get stuck on the packaging, the astral packaging of it, and then we'll end up needing to go back to the more dense just to remind ourselves how terrible this packaging is. I don't want any of that package form at all. And then that'll maybe help us pass the astral plane. That is possible. That is possible. But certainly, get the context right. That is, this is a reflection. What we're seeing is a reflection of our own idea of wanting, desiring reality to fail to be what it is. So we're just hanging out here on this incredibly beautiful spring day, May day, here in Bay Area of California. And soft breezes, beautiful temperature, lovely light, flowers everywhere, greenery everywhere, and of course no water anywhere. Just a moment. All right, much to-ing and fro-ing and activity here. That happens. Try to stay just calm, poised. Do not invest your feeling in the superficial. Don't invest your feeling there. You can nod and smile, but don't get wrapped up in any storyline into your feelings. No. Keep it, say, hey, there's something more important we're dealing with here, the continuity issue, the continuity problem. How do we evaporate it as soon as quickly as possible? The way is to be able to absorb the breakthroughs, absorb the beauty. Now, if we get a beautiful song, we say, okay, I want to listen to this all day, every day, every day, every day. I've done that a lot, and that's not it. It doesn't work. What we need to absorb is this crestfallenness, actually, prior to the beauty. It is to realize, wow, I could have had this beauty all along, and I've been denying myself this for so long. There's that feeling. That comes first. We have to be able to allow that feeling to dissipate and forgive ourselves, really. Because really, the recognition is I didn't have to be without this ever. And I've tried to imagine myself without this, without everything that I want, really want. And wow, we have time for forgiveness. Have to forgive ourselves for doing this. Really, all forgiveness is self-forgiveness. So, of course, when we have a breakthrough, the flip side of that is we start thinking, say, wait a minute, I've been depriving myself of this all along. And then we'll go over to say, wait a minute, maybe there must be some significance to depriving myself of this, to try and rationalize the feeling away. Like, wow. Wow. Very crestfallen. And we say, no, we rationalize and say, no, God wants us to have been depriving ourselves of this, and it's all part of God's plan to experience everything, and blah, 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 blah. It's rationalization that delays us. Don't rationalize it. Say, no, I have been imagining myself deprived of what I really want, and I am feeling pretty bummed out about that. When you experience the beauty, then you ask yourself the question, why haven't I been experiencing this before? And the answer is, you could have. I could have been all along. And he said, wow. There then comes the backlash, you see. So, just say, that's no longer an issue. I've worked it out. I understand. I was trying to be greater than God. I've given that up. So now the only question is the continuity issue. There are no other issues at all. No other issues. So I'm forgiving myself. I've forgiven myself. So now let's just work on getting used to it. Don't rationalize it. Therefore, you do feel this feeling of sort of a deep dismay, like, my gosh, to be without this, that's terrible, that's nuts. But then you forgive yourself and you recognize, okay, since I've been imagining myself without this, obviously I have a continuity problem. And so I need to work on that. Give myself the opportunity as much as possible to get over this dismay and to abide in the beauty. So it's no longer a stupidity problem. It's a continuity problem now. You transfer it. You see, this is called forgiveness. If you want to know what forgiveness is, it is transferring all problems we think we have over to the continuity problem and saying, that's the only problem I have. That's real forgiveness, actually. Because from there, you're able to actually work on abiding in it and evaporate the continuity problem away, which is what we really want. So we say, well, we don't have a stupidity problem, we have a continuity problem. We don't have an imbecility problem, we have a continuity problem. Let's work on that, actually, just 1 second. Okay, I don't have an ill-advised problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a moronic problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a fool-headed problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a whimsical problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have an unbalanced problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a delirious, demented, deranged problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have an idiotic, crazy, stupid problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a problem with an illogic problem. I don't have an illogical problem, an unreasoned problem, ill-conceived problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any wacky, goofy, daft, potty, loopy, ditzy problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a problem, a folly problem. I have a continuity problem. That's it. So I'm forgiving myself. Say, yeah, I used to be that way, but I'm not stupid, ill-conceived, all this. Now I realized my folly, and now I only have a continuity problem. And I'm not confusing the continuity problem with these other previous problems. Don't have those anymore. I've forgiven myself. So if we forgive ourselves, we're able to see the only problem we have now is the continuity problem, no other problem. Because we say, okay, I'm no longer trying to compete with God. I'm no longer trying to be greater than God. I'm no longer trying to change reality, which is completely impractical, stupid, blockheaded, ill-conceived, unhinged, half-witted, dumb, and dumber, folly, impossibility, hypothetical scenario. All of that, I no longer have those problems. That don't have that as a problem anymore whatsoever. It's all just the continuity problem is my problem now, nothing else. So I'm not working on trying to get smarter, you know. I'm just working on evaporating the continuity problem. I'm not working on trying to cure my dumbness, cure my preposterousness, you know, completely. Idiotic daftness. I'm not working on my idiocy. I'm not an idiot because I recognize the situation. I have a continuity problem, so I'm no longer stupid or idiotic or dumb or zany or flaky or off the wall, half-witted at all. I'm now entirely intelligent. I say, okay, I just have a continuity problem. That is true intelligence because it's a fact. When we try to encompass the impossible, what is the problem we have? A continuity problem. We don't have an impossibility problem. The impossible is not a problem. It can never be a problem. By seeing it's a problem, we think there's a way to, if we're just smart enough, to solve it. There is no way to solve the impossible. Changing reality, that's not a problem. We can't change reality, so how is it a problem? It's only a continuity problem in that our imagining it can be changed, or, you know, say, well, what if it could be? We've gotten used to it, and we've gotten used to denying reality. And so all we have to do is set the denial down. That's not a problem. But the continuity problem is there now. Too much glory. You know, too much glory. It seems overwhelming. Because it no form can contain it. No form can define it. See, the glory of reality, of God, it cannot be, ever be contained. It always overflows. Overflows. It's always overflowing. And so therefore it's always transcending any definition, any form, any appearance. Inherently transcendent. And that's what we're not used to. So I forgive myself. I now only have a continuity problem. And the way we work with that is to, again, mood of repentance, so we can absorb the breakthroughs. If we saw this radiant mountain of beauty right now, we'd say, wow, we just have to absorb that. Just get used to it. I'm not trying to solve any other problem except the continuity problem. I'm not trying to fix anything. Nothing needs to be fixed. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened to reality. So what needs to be fixed? Unreality? Why do we need to fix unreality? We just set it down. Really, we just imagine an abyss. There isn't any abyss. So just set the desire to imagine, dream an abyss down. And then we have a continuity issue, because we're so used to thinking we're dwelling in an abyss, that to realize there is no abyss at all, it's like, whoa, it's overwhelming. So since our only problem is the continuity problem, when we see the mountain of beauty, we just say, okay, how does that relate to the continuity problem? Oh, just get used to it. That's why is it here? It's for the continuity problem, to solve the continuity problem. Okay, and how is it solved? By getting used to it, as it is. Not by trying to change it, not by trying to package it, imprison it, distribute it, just as it is. Just get used to it as it is, the beauty as it is, without trying to do anything. Don't have to know what it is. Right? It's all overflowing. Whatever known, something is known, meaning it has a form, boundaries. This is overflowing. It's not defined or known. Is endlessness known? The knowing that reality has is different than the knowing that we're used to. So we have to say, no, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. Because we're only talking with perception and appearances, thinking that this is knowledge. It's not knowledge. I don't know. I don't need to know anything. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to be anything. Just need to have the continuity problem solved. And when the beauty arises, you say, okay, what's it here for? Oh, continuity problem. Okay, very great. Just let that. Just get used to it. Just get used to it. And of course, because we have a continuity problem, we realize the dismay that arises from having gone for so long depriving ourselves of the beauty is going to be there. So we're going to feel, don't get caught on the rebound thinking. Just say, ah, the dismay is there, the upset is there, wow. But I've forgiven myself for the whimsical attempt to change reality. So I'm not going to get angry at myself. I'm just going to feel the hurt. There's some hurt there, like, wow, how awful that I've been deprived of this for so long. How awful. It's my own whim that brought this about. So recognize that, the feeling. Recognize the feeling. Continuity problem. The feeling, only feeling arises is kind of this deep ache, like, oh, wow, I've been without this, wow. I've been without this teaching, I've been without this clarity, I've been without this. It's such a deep, don't do anything about the ache, just let it evaporate. Don't get sucked into thinking about it. Say, well, what is this, what is it, projecting it. No projection, just, there's an ache. I say, ah, you see the beautiful mountain, the mountain of that's just emanating, the beauty and the freshness and the pure tone and the fragrance and the shimmering, glimmering, glowing, endless, fresh, clean, pure beauty. And you just say, wow, that's great. And I know I'm going to have this sense of regret that I've been without this. So just let that regret gradually forgive, 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 forgive. That's it. Just abide in this sense of pure forgiveness. No struggle. The ache of regret is there. And then that nothing else, just let it naturally, gradually evaporate through forgiveness. Because we ask, well, how come we don't have this vision of oneness? You know, where is it? Well, the ache of regret, you see the vision of oneness and you say, this is incredible. This is what I've always really wanted. Here it is, this is great. And then a little voice and you says, God, can you believe how terrible it's been that you haven't had this? And then you say, oh yeah, wow, all this time I could have had this. And then the regret comes in. So you have to realize this will happen. Until we get to a point where we say, okay, there's no more reason to indulge in any regrets at all. Because that just adds more to it, right? Because you're not experiencing it right now either. Pure forgiveness is, total forgiveness is where we don't even have any feeling of regret at all. It's no longer needed to indulge in that at all. That's still part of the continuity fear, is regrets. It's still part of it. But it's a part that most likely will definitely arise. We all have peak moments, and what happens? Well, we say, wow, how stupid that I haven't had this before. Why am I so stupid? And then you start thinking about that. We say, no thinking. We know it's just a continuity problem is all. We're not stupid. We have a continuity problem. I don't have a stupidity problem. I have a continuity problem. The stupidity problem has no value to me. In other words, struggling with why am I so stupid, trying to solve that issue. No. We already know that it was our own adventurousness, our whimsicality, our desire to experience everything and say, hey, how about being God, you know? Be greater than God. Change, let's say we can change reality. Stupid whimsicality out of maybe overly adventurous, just out of our sense of how adventurous can we be. Now we know, okay, no worries. We don't get caught in stupid. I don't have a stupidity problem, I have a continuity problem. Don't get caught in stupid. I don't have a stupidity problem, I have a continuity problem. The stupidity problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. That's it. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Even regrets don't have value. I don't have a regret problem, I have a continuity problem. So we're getting smarter about this, right? And that's all important. That's what saves delay. Otherwise, we'll just be in this endless loop of, you know, little glimpse regret, and just go on forever. We have to be aware and intelligent and manage the situation properly. Don't struggle with the regret, just forgive yourself and let it evaporate. You're thinking, oh my God, you mean I've been stuck with all these special relationships that were just hell, and all this time was the one relationship I could have experienced that the whole, oh, what am I doing? You know, what did I do? Regret. No, I just have a continuity problem. I don't have any of these issues anymore. Don't have those problems. Just a continuity problem. Okay, so let's just get used to this vision of oneness. How does it feel? Let's just get used to it. So you keep going to the full stop. Now full stop, continuity problem, full stop. Continuity problem, full stop. Continuity fear, full stop. Like that. And you're gathering your attention, you're gathering your will. See, that way. All right, so just know that there is this incredible beauty and glory and tone and light within us, just there. And we do have the means, the way and the means now to allow and remove the blocks to that, stay in the mood of repentance, and more and more get closer and closer and closer to that. We're very close to it actually right now, very, very close. Okay, I'll wrap this one video up, that's it.